So, when the dislocation motion happens in a single crystal, then the dislocation motion or the slip happens, but while the slip is happening, it has to follow certain geometric conditions. That means, what are those conditions? The spacing of the planes remains constant. So, overall, that the spacing of the planes should be remaining constant, and the number of planes in the specimen is conserved. You cannot have more number of planes just because you are causing dislocation, right? So, that leads to these two conditions, L cos phi and L sin lambda being constant. L is the length of the crystal. So, if you see this picture here, this is your L and D is your interplanar spacing, right? And this is your tensile axis, lambda is your angle between the loading direction and the slip direction, okay? So, your D, you can actually show that D equal to L by N. So, this is D, L by N cos phi. Similarly, you can also write a relation between D and lambda. This is 90 minus lambda, D is equal to L by N cos 90 minus lambda, right? So, then from that you can actually show that ND equal to L cos phi, and we know that number of N is your number of planes, and they should be remaining constant, and interplanar spacing should remain constant. So, both of them are constant, and hence L cos phi should be constant. So, during plastic deformation, always this quantity should remain constant, and L sin lambda, I think N is equal to, there should be L here, L sin lambda should be constant. This is the geometric requirement while we are doing dislocation, when the plastic deformation is taking place in these single crystal materials. Okay, now a brief note on what is the stress state around a dislocation. So, that means we have discussed in yesterday's class, if you have a perfect crystal and you introduce a half plane, right, then we have seen that above the slip plane, all the atoms around the dislocation will experience a state of compression, and all the atoms below the slip plane experience a state of tension. So, that means mere presence of the dislocation is actually creating a local stress field, right. So, what, how does the stress state evolve, or stress state changes as a function of space around the dislocation core is what is going to be shown here. So, stress field around a screw dislocation. So, this is the typical example of a screw dislocation, and this is your Burgess vector, and this is your z direction. And since it is a screw dislocation, you will not have displacement in x and y direction. So, ux, uy equal to 0, and z, uz is b theta by 2 pi, because b is your, so here, starting here, the b is 0, and as you increase up to 2 pi, it goes from 0 to b, right? You are going around this parking garage to go to the next floor to park, right? That means you have moved by this amount. In order to move by this amount b, you have to make a rotation of 2 pi, right? So, uz can be written as b times theta by 2 pi, or in other words, in terms of x and y, you can write this way, and then your strain components will only be epsilon xz, epsilon yz, right? And then your shear stress around the dislocation are given by, that means the screw dislocation will only cause shear stresses, and edge dislocation, again we are not showing the derivation here as well. This is the edge dislocation where the displacement is only this way, right? And you can actually cause equivalent, you can also write expressions for ux, ui, and hence you will be able to derive the expressions for sigma xx, sigma yy, sigma xy. That means, if you have an edge dislocation, if it is your edge dislocation, the kind of stress state that you would observe is something like that, around this, right? And if you see here, below this guy, you will see here you have compression, here you will have tension, right? This is tension and that is compression, and then there will be some shear also, right? So a edge dislocation can actually cause both normal as well as shear stresses, whereas crude dislocation will only cause shear stresses. And you can actually go back and look into how this dislocation, if you would plot the variation of stress around the dislocation core, you will see how the stress variation is going to take place. Okay. So far we have discussed the onset of plastic deformation through slip, right? Dislocation motion and through slip. There is also another important deformation mechanism after slip, is called twinning. Twinning is a special kind of a deformation mechanism wherein the atoms should move. So if you would remember our first experiment of creating causing slip, is that you break open all the bonds in the plane and then you re-establish bond, right? Then there are no dislocations. That means you are expecting a certain way of the movement, certain kind of a movement of atoms between these two planes, right? Now the twinning, so let us say this is your perfect crystal and let us say this is our twin plane. Like slip plane, you have a twin plane and you are applying shear stress. Then you should have a coordinated atom motion across the slip plane in such a way that after you have caused the slip through twinning, you will see that the atoms have taken a mirror image position. So, for instance, if this is your initial crystal structure, crystal that is, and now these are your original shapes, original positions of atoms. The dot dashed atoms are original positions. By causing slip, what happened was, with respect to the atoms on this side, these atoms have moved in such a way that this becomes a mirror image of this guy, and this becomes a mirror image of this guy, this becomes a mirror image of this guy, and so on. So your atom motion is such that you will always find across the twin plane, you will see the mirror images of atoms from one side to the other. And if your motion is of that kind, and such a deformation mechanism is called twinning. Again, here we have not used dislocation. We have just said that the atoms have to move that way. Like in the case of shear by glide of plane of atoms, here also you can have a plane of atoms moving in such a way that they become mirror images of atoms on the other side of the twin plane. Is that clear? And hence, if you were to calculate the shear stress required to cause twinning, is going to be much larger when you cause such a deformation through dislocation motion. That means you really don't have to move all the atoms at once, but you can actually move one atom after the other, like in the case of slip that we have caused through dislocation motion. Similarly, you can also cause twinning through dislocation motion. Okay? And then the amount of stress required to cause twin deformation is going to be much less compared to the theoretical shear strength required for causing twinning. Right? So here also the dislocations will help. So a shear force can produce atomic displacement such that one side of a plane, that is twin boundary, one side of a plane, atoms are located in mirror image positions of atoms on the other side, as we have seen that. Okay? Typically, the stress required to form twins is generally much higher, but it is not really dependent so much on temperature, whereas the slip, it is the other way around. So, slip, amount of stress required to cause slip compared to twin is usually much smaller, and that is why in FCC materials particularly, The amount of stress required to cause twinning is usually much higher at room temperatures and high temperatures compared to amount of stress required to cause slip through dislocation. Okay. So, deformation twinning is usually the mechanism for plastic deformation in HCP metals at high strain rates and low temperature. Very in specific situations, FCC metals also deform by twinning when your loading rate is very high and the temperature is very low. And when you are operating at very low temperatures, then the shear stress required to cause dislocation motion to slip is gonna be much higher. And hence, at very high strain rates and very low temperatures, FCC metals also might show twinning. Okay. So, this is the microstructure, micrograph of tungsten showing twin deformation, where you see the serrations or the twin steps in the material. So, what is the, how do we compare the slip versus twin? When you are having slip, the crystallographic orientation above and below the slip plane is same before and after the deformation. The crystallographic orientation, if you have a slip plane, the orientation above the slip plane and below the slip plane is going to remain the same. But here, in the case of twin, you are actually going to alter that, right? The reorientation of crystals occur in twin. So, what is the meaning of that? So, you have a slip plane, let us assume. So, then you are actually in the twin, across the twin boundary, you are changing the orientation of the crystal lattice. The reorientation of the system is occurring. And that might actually trigger slip, because the reoriented systems might now become active slip systems because of the change in orientation, because the loading is same, but these guys are rotating. Because of this rotation, the Smith factor on these slip systems might be higher, cause initiating the deformation through slip, right. So, the twinning can also sometimes assist in enhancing the slip. That is also usually observed in several systems. So, slip occurs in distinct atomic spacing multiples. So, when we are talking about slip, we only say that in terms of integer multiples of Burgess vector, right? Isn't it? We don't say 1.5 billion. Whereas in twin, the displacement usually less than the interatomic spacing that we have seen, because this is your interatomic spacing, right? But here, this point has moved only a smaller distance to become mirror image to this guy. And hence, usually the slip is, the twin displacement is usually less than the interatomic space. And as I have already mentioned, since twinning can reorient crystal planes, it can also place new planes in a favorable orientation for slip to occur. So, you sometimes in some materials, you may actually start the deformation with the twinning, but because the twinning can reorient the crystal planes, then because of this reorientation, you might actually trigger slip as a consequence of higher Smith factor on the reoriented slip systems. Okay? Alright, I think I will stop there, and tomorrow's class we will, not tomorrow, tomorrow we don't have class. So, in, tomorrow we have tutorial, right? Tutorial at 4:40, 4:50. MSB 243, we will meet at 4:50 in tomorrow. Any questions? You please go back and read whatever is discussed in today's class. Otherwise, it will quickly evaporate and it can cause a lot of pain at a later stage.